Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Class A Threat by Dan Sugralinov, translated by Andrew Schmidt, narrated by Daniel Thomas May. Chapter 1. Sandbox. For my birthday, my parents got me an Infinitum 8. Not a very expensive model of immersion pot, but one of the best in its class. It was the present I most wanted for my 14th birthday, because that is the age you can finally start playing the coolest and most popular game on the planet, Disgardium. As soon as the birthday party was over and the guests had left, Dad smiled.
Can't wait to test it out?
I nodded. How could I? An immersion pod is not some steam-powered VR helmet with sensor gloves. Go on then, Alex, Mom said and laughed, embracing Dad.
Don't go in too long your first time, he shouted after me. Alex?
Yes, Dad, I answered, almost running to my room where the new pod awaited me. Just think, it was already installed, calibrated, and ready to use. I hurriedly got undressed and went inside. It was vertical, but could change orientation to better reflect the virtual world. Gravity is a heartless little bitch, and it's difficult to convince someone that they're standing when their real body is horizontal. I grabbed the metal handles and waited. A few seconds passed, but nothing happened. Was this thing defective? I was about to run down and call the manufacturer when a stern voice rang out in the pod.
Alex, your heartbeat is too rapid for your first immersion experience. Access denied.
Oh, come on, I shouted.
Apologies for the inconvenience, but characters can only be generated in baseline physical state,
the voice muttered, probably quoting the user's manual. Then it followed up with some helpful advice.
Alex, please do your best to calm down and try again. Thank you.
With a sigh, I climbed out of the pod and walked out onto the little balcony off my room. There were all kinds of silvery delivery drones flitting about on the backdrop of the starry sky, landing and taking off from the windows of our huge residential complex. Higher up, a procession of public flying cars darkened the sky. As of today, I was legally allowed to pilot them without computer control. I couldn't wait to try it out. Of course, I would have to pass the license test first, but I had no doubts about that. A cloud of condensation burst out of my mouth. The cold, damp wind made me shiver, even though earlier today it was pretty clearly turning to spring. A few minutes later, I was calm and back in the pod. This time I saw no warnings, and the immersion process was able to initiate. Intragel flooded the pod, going over my head, but it was perfectly all right to breathe. Finally, I closed my eyes. And when I opened them again, I was in outer space. The sensation of weightlessness took my breath away, and I could barely resist waving my arms and legs. Not that there was much reason to. The pod assumed control over my muscles, keeping them static, while the intragel kept my body suspended and out of harm's way. That way, if something went wrong and it lost control of my body, the gel would protect me from injury.
Good evening, Alex. Please select your preferred immersion environment.
The text was immediately read out by a breathy female voice. In terms of environments, there wasn't much choice. I had the moon-sized test world Infinitum, made to demonstrate the pod's capabilities, or the huge Disgardium, which came factory pre-installed on all pods. And that was what I chose. Some system logs ran before my eyes. Biological age confirmed. Access to Disgardium permitted. Notifying Department of Education, complete. Status confirmed. Initiating first immersion experience. Scanning body, complete. Character appearance generated. Approved world type, sandbox. Recommended location, Tristad. Unfortunately, I would be relegated to a sandbox until I reached 16. They were private locations where only underage players were allowed. Adults from the full version were not permitted, and all content was strictly age-appropriate. All around me, I saw a flurry of majestic cities and abandoned villages, epic battles and ghastly monsters, the six not yet entirely explored continents, heavenly gardens and fiery wastelands, A billion active players and just as many non-player characters, which was to say nothing of non-citizen workers. Seaside resorts and city blocks, teeming with forbidden pleasures.
Welcome to Disgardium, Alex. Welcome to a world where dozens of non-human races live in harmony. A world where sword and magic reign. A world where anyone could one day become a king or hero. A world where you'll want to live. A world where fate...
I didn't even think of interrupting the intro, savoring the massive scale and brilliant colors of this world that was so recently off limits. I had been dreaming of this moment for far too long. The primer on Disgardium came to an end. I was immersed in darkness for an instant, and then suddenly found myself in a room full of people. It was a few boys and girls. We were all wearing identical canvas garb and looking around in surprise. I was just overcome and couldn't hide my glee. It was all so real. The wooden floor creaked underfoot, rafters peeked out from behind the high ceiling, and light from the windows jumped along the walls, playing off our shadows. I could smell a sappy tree. Dust whirled in the rays of the sun. The canvas shirt fit loosely over my body, and when I touched it, I could feel my ribs through the fabric. Unbelievable!
Whoa!
Shrieked a girl with long black hair.
Who pinched me?
Everyone laughed. The girl sneezed, and that caused a new burst of laughter. Happy birthday, all! I shouted.
Happy birthday!
Rang out discordantly through the laughter. All of us had just reached our 14th year, that was obvious. Who in their right mind would put off their first taste of Disgardium? Hey, wait a minute. Shouldn't we be seeing our names?
We haven't even generated characters yet, dummy.
In our feverish anticipation, we didn't notice at first, but the door had opened.
Welcome, new visitors of Tristad,
came a sonorous male voice. We turned. In the doorway, hiding a smile in his whiskers, there stood a respectable man with graying locks. Over him hovered the words, Peter Whiteacre, level 30, chief councilman of the city of Tristad.
It is my pleasure to welcome you to the free city of Tristad, where everyone has a place, be they hero or warrior, bard or wise man, hunter or mage, druid or common quarry worker.
The councilman listed a few more series of classes and professions. Then he ran down the list of races inhabiting the Commonwealth.
And we are equally glad to see people, elves, and gnomes.
For my part, I was quite engaged. Studying information online was one thing, but finally becoming part of all this was another. The councilman then gave us a brief overview of the state of the world. All races of the Commonwealth were at war with hordes of orcs and barbaric non-human tribes. They also repelled raids from the Nether and the senseless attacks of the Reavers, and resisted the Dark Brotherhoods, the Sleeping Gods, the Goblin League. Lots of things happened in this world, and it was possible that some of us would remain in the Commonwealth after transitioning to the adult world. Others would certainly take the chance and change their character to a different faction, though.
I can see that you're all tired from the long journey,
Whiteacre said finally.
Now please complete your registration with Carlson the Scribe. Then I'll answer any questions you may have. If you have no questions, go out and see the city, meet its inhabitants, and bring it good fortune.
We started heading toward the registration desk. There was a plump, rosy-cheeked scribe sitting there. I took up the back of the line.
Complete these arrival forms, said Carlson, handing them out.
That paper, once in hand, unfolded into a character registration form. In a sandbox, you could only play a person, so it wasn't clear why Whiteacre had listed all the races of the Commonwealth. And we could only choose a class at level 10, so now we could only fill in our name and allocate attribute points. There was a name I was planning to use for a long time, ever since my dad read me tales from ancient history as bedtime stories. Name? Scythe. Confirmed. I might have said it had no meaning, but that wasn't true. I hope I can live up to the name.
Scythe, you have 15 main attribute points. In many ways, your attributes will determine your entire life in Disgardium, from your combat strategy to the way others perceive you. Take your time and think carefully. Your attributes cannot be reset.
In school, I heard that no matter what class you choose, you need a 10 at least in every attribute. Strength, so I could carry lots of weight, agility and perception, so I wouldn't miss my targets and land critical hits. Intelligence defined mana regeneration, and mana was used to make special attacks, even for warriors. And with low charisma, I could forget about good quests and discounts from vendors. Luck, meanwhile, had a small impact on just about everything. So then, after some brief thought, I put 2 into each one. I added the extra points to endurance without really thinking, just because it was there. Scythe, level 1 human. Real name, Alex Shepherd. Real age, 14. Class, not selected. Main attributes, strength, 2. Perception, 2. Endurance, 3. Charisma, 2. Intelligence, 2. Agility, 2. Luck, 2. All finished, I handed my arrival form to the scribe. He scanned it, snorted, and gave a strained smile and, with exaggerated enthusiasm, announced, "Welcome to Tristad, Scythe." When I emerged, I stopped on the stairs, looking down the central street dreamily and smiling. "Disgardium, say hello to your new hero."
Chapter 2. A year and a half later.
There was only 5 minutes left in class, and the students were starting to get restless.
"The bell hasn't rung yet,"
Greg Kovacs, our history teacher, noted sternly.
"Take your seats. Edward, sit down this instant."
Ed Rodriguez, leader of the Dementors clan, was scraping his desk along the floor. He quickly sat back down despite himself. Modern history was our last lesson for today, and he just couldn't wait to get back into Disgardium.
"I'm not finished," Greg frowned. "All right, kids, class is extended by 2 minutes. You know who to thank."
"But teacher,"
Ed objected.
"Mr. Kovacs."
"No buts, Rodriguez."
Tissa, the blonde girl sitting behind Ed, hissed out something that sounded very much like shit. She was in Ed's clan, and seemingly they had a raid scheduled today.
"Let's make that 3 minutes, Melissa Schaefer," the teacher corrected himself nonchalantly. He continued the lecture. "After the collapse of the world banking system."
Tissa rolled her eyes and gave a loud sigh, not unclenching her lips. Ed, turning around, blew her a kiss. Tissa shot him a middle finger back.
"The UN, Greg said,
writing the name on the whiteboard and underlining it.
"That led to the creation of the World Wide Bank and the Global Monetary Union. Who can tell me what their new unit of currency was called?"
"The Phoenix," the class answered in unison.
"Exactly," the teacher nodded. "And who knows what a phoenix looks like?"
Silence. Knowing Mr. Kovacs, it was better to answer. Otherwise, we could end up sitting here for half an hour. "The phoenix is a mythological bird that can burn itself up and rise from the ashes," I said. "The first written mention of the phoenix myth is found in Herodotus."
"I appreciate your knowledge of mythology, Alex, but I was asking about the currency. The phoenix doesn't have a material form. It is a digital currency, independent of economic and political considerations. In the same year, another important change took place in society."
He had moved on to the mandatory citizenship tests. Ours would be coming soon enough, and Greg touched on the pitiful existence non-citizens were shackled to, the fact that they outnumbered citizens and that they were dying en masse, abandoned and forgotten by society. But by the end, no one was listening anymore. For the last seconds of our extra minutes, we were drumming on our desks and shouting out a countdown.
3, 2, 1.
The thunder of every chair scooting back at once drowned out our homework assignment and the date of an upcoming test. The Dementors were the first out of class, driven on by Ed. They took Disgardium seriously because they saw it as their future. Snowstorm Incorporated, the developer, was the first company to ever pay people to game. And since then, it is the most widely played full immersion game on Earth, even receiving certification from the United Nations itself. And now it was where non-citizens and underqualified citizens spent their days and earned their money. For many, it was the only way to improve their lot in life. But definitely not for me. It had been a year and a half since I first loaded up Dis. I remember thinking I was very clever investing equally in all attributes. How wrong I was. That gave me a character with piss-poor damage and dispiriting aim. I was hardly fit to live. Unfortunately, even though I had read a few guides before my first session, I never read the best way to make a new character. I knew that every level would give me 5 attribute points, so I figured if anything was wrong, I could just fix it in no time at all. Gaining just a few levels seemed trivial. But it wasn't all puppies and rainbows. Bots were in no rush to give me quests, and farming mobs turned out to not only be tedious but difficult. Level 1 rats refused to be easy farming and took me down in a couple of bites every time. I had to land 10 or so blows, constantly swinging, just to take down one. And that was if I had someone holding the rat for me. And when I joined a group of beginners like me, those drips of experience turned into mere dewdrops. When I realized that, my enthusiasm was extinguished. And this wasn't exactly an uncommon experience. Some just stopped playing. Others opted for social quests. But leveling like that was hopelessly boring and never-ending. Just to get 1 experience point, for example, you had to spend a few hours doing social labor like cleaning stables or pulling weeds. 1/2 year in the game to get a couple levels? Oh, never. And one day I quit the game. But the next I was inspired by the success of a few classmates and entered again with new hopes and plans. But the longer I played, the more disenchanted I grew. At the beginning, I couldn't get any equipment, armor, or weapons. The lowliest knife in the weapons store cost a few silver, and I'd have had to complete 50 social quests to get just 1 silver coin. Fight rats with my bare hands? Ha! Those things were so big they'd have the upper hand on a Rottweiler IRL. And even if I could kill one, the reward was just 1 experience point, maybe 2 if I got really lucky. So in the end, I just couldn't stand it. After a few weeks trying every which way to level, my experience bar was no more than 5% full. I didn't even hit level 2. For some reason known only to the developers, it was impossible to delete a character and create a new one from scratch in sandboxes. Maybe that was to make us take more responsibility for our decisions. Meanwhile, I was disgusted by the idea of spending real money on the game, both then and now. I mean, I knew how hard up my parents were for cash. It wasn't like basic gear would cost some astronomical amount, but by the time I considered it, Dis had already lost its charm to me. Sure, at first it was fun to explore a totally new world with its own laws, rules, geography, history, and races. It even had different physics, given both magic and teleportation were possible. But that was only truly enthralling for the first few days. Weeding or respawning time and again after the fatal bite of some overgrown spider? No thanks. What was more, my heart yearned for outer space. The first settlements were being made on Mars, and it seemed to me that exploring a real new world was somewhat more interesting than a virtual one. I greedily devoured any materials I could find about space expeditions, studied the requirements for getting into university, and prepared for exams. My parents supported my ambitions, too, and had set some money aside for my studies. But I still had to play Dis, and every day. From the age of 14, everyone was required to spend at least 1 hour per day in the game. Snowstorm Inc.'s long tendrils reached deep into the UN Department of Education. Now it was thought to be an important part of a child's education, providing necessary social skills and preparing us for adult life, whether in the real world or Disgardium. Every day was exactly the same for me there. I usually spent the whole hour sitting on a bench opposite the bubbling flagon tavern. Just after I entered the game, the neighbor girl, Eve O'Sullivan, would come join me. She couldn't stand even a hint of pain, so she didn't find the game much fun either. And for that reason, she would sit around killing time with me. The sooner we got our citizenship tests, the better. After that, I could be done with this onerous requirement. With that thought in mind, I hurried to leave school. Our parking lot had a limited number of public flying cars, and if you didn't manage to get one on your first go-round, you'd have to wait for one to come back. And that's just what happened. Or, more accurately, one of the last ones still had an empty seat, but I wanted one to myself so I could drive it manually. The school lot was on the roof, next to a solar panel array. Eve was sitting there. She always waited for me so we could fly home together. Her father's business was really taking off, but they were still in our apartment complex.
Alex!
Eve's face lit up. I might have thought she liked me, but that didn't do anything for me. She was sweet, but not at all to my taste. Plus, she didn't mind her figure, eating chocolate bars in quantities that far surpassed Department of Health guidelines.
How was your day?
Like normal, Eve. 2 periods of ethics of modern society, 2 of programming domestic robots, and 2 of modern history. Dullsville.
Oh, God, I never understood why we need history,
she shouted. Then she changed her voice, trying to parody Greg's distinctive manner of speaking.
The last president of the United States.
Eve got distracted and started thinking. I threw off the backpack and sat down next to her. All the flying cars were gone, so we would have to wait here at least 10 minutes. Then a tarry column of acrid bitumen shot up into the air from the asphalt of the launch pad.
That damned diss again,
she sighed.
When are you going to play today? Right after you eat like normal?
The sooner I start, the sooner I can finish. Then I can do whatever I want.
So, what would you rather be doing?
Eve asked, emphasizing the word rather. She even attempted a languid tone, drawing out the last word and cocking an eye. Oh, nether. Flirting was definitely not her strong suit. Where had she seen that move? Nevertheless, I was caught off guard. Probably not what you had in mind, I answered with a smile. I didn't want to offend her. She was a great girl, and I had known her since childhood. I'll be studying materials on the Lehman expedition to Mars.
I see. I just thought maybe you'd want to...
What? I didn't want to embarrass her, but it was better to break this off before it turned into an upwelling of unjustified hope.
Maybe we could watch it together?
She blurted out in one breath. Sorry, not today. My parents are working on a new project. I don't want us to distract them. I tactically said us, although I meant only her. My father and mother had finally gotten an easy order, but the client was fickle and it was best to keep risks to a minimum. Money had been tight for us recently. Dad suspected Mom was having an affair, which was driving him more and more to the bottle, and when he drank, he got paranoid, suspicious, and aggressive. Mom, of course, didn't like that, and so she left home on the sly and came back around morning. I definitely think she's seeing someone. Their constant fighting ruined my mood so much I didn't even want to do my homework. And that was a problem. To get into university, I need high average points.
We can watch it at my place.
Eve wouldn't relent. We can talk about that later, I answered, hoping that by then her spark would have gone out. Flying cars began returning to the parking lot. We got into one, and I gave a nod to Eve.
So are you flying or the computer?
Me. I changed steering to manual and took off into the air. Flying. What could be better? Only the stars.
Chapter 3. Bad News.
After eating, I went on dis. Eve and I sat on the bench across from the bubbling flagon tavern, which was, by the way, the only one in all of Tristat. We just chatted and looked around. The city had a rhythm all its own. Players ran around willy-nilly, coursing between the market square, bank, and the auction. There was so much noise that 20 minutes after loading, I truly wished I could know what it was like to be deaf. Everyone around was screaming, arguing, negotiating, inviting people to groups and just formed clans. The energetic whooping of criers and barkers for local merchants and craftsmen cut into the din. Maneuvering between them all was a challenge with my low attributes. Couriers and other low-level players were darting here and there, carrying out social quests for the city. And they all ignored the red-faced, town-drunk Patrick, just pretending that he didn't exist. That's how much he bothered everyone. That unlovable bot was always begging for a copper. Yet there were rumors that if you cranked your reputation with him up to max, you could get some legendary quest. but few had tried because at a rate of one rep per copper, it was too steep for most noobs. A bit further down the street, some restless gnomes were causing a ruckus with a group of dignified dwarves. Even from so far away, I could tell that they were negotiating to buy some new gnomish invention, and both were driving a hard bargain. A city guardsman was standing at the entrance to the tavern, watching passers-by like a hawk. By the way, in the sandbox taverns, players were only served cream beer. No alcohol. Explicit language was bleeped and penalized with experience points, too. What was more, it wasn't even possible to get fully undressed here. Instead of sex organs, we all had nothing down there. Like a child's doll. Too bad, of course. I had no problems with girls, but the very thought of something greater than a normal conversation made me twitch. I would not have said no to a bit of practice. Just so you know, that does not apply to Eve O'Sullivan, though. Not one bit. Though, based on her chosen nick, Aphrodite, she may have had a different opinion. Still, I couldn't discount the possibility that she simply didn't know who that was. When I did dream of taking it further than a chat, it was always with Tissa Schaefer. And it just so happened that she was walking on the other side of the street with Ed and the other guys from the clan just then. They were talking loudly and laughing. Based on how they were barely moving their legs, they were all encumbered and heading to auction on the market square, to the smith or to a merchant stall to get rid of all their loot before another raid. They probably didn't have anything of value, maybe just a hunk of rusty scrap from the mine of the hyena-like gnolls. That was not the most complicated instance, but it had to be done for raiding the dungeon of the man-eating ogres where they were going. And maybe they were planning to go run the new ints in the Olten quarries, which everyone was talking about in school.
"Does she have to shake her thighs like that?"
Eve asked in annoyance, looking at Tissa. I led my gaze over Melissa's tall and well-proportioned figure, wrapped in the short white dress of a priestess of Nergal the Radiant, the main deity in this world. At the very least, it was the god with the most adherents, and thus faith points. I couldn't look away. It was a captivating spectacle, and only Eve's look of admonishment in the corner of my eye made me stop leering at Tissa Schaefer's backside. Here, all characters were an exact copy of the people who played them, but in the real world, Tissa never wore clothes like that. There, she usually loafed around in oversized pants and baggy hoodies, so I could only admire her here. And that was the only thing I liked about this game. Of all the players I knew in Tristat, only she and Ed Crawler Rodriguez had become mages. Magic was an inalienable part of the world. In theory, anyone here could master it, but it cost unspeakable sums of cash to learn. A tome of basic magic of any school cost at least 10,000 gold. That was approximately the same number of phoenixes, about the same as a flying car. But neither of them bought any tomes. Tissa randomly found a quest object that brought her on a long chain where the final reward was light magic training in the Temple of Nergal the Radiant. And Ed got the fire magic class supposedly after finding a tome as loot in an instance. Either fate had been kind to him or he was just entitled to the loot as the clan leader. I didn't know for sure.
"I'm bored,"
said Eve, looking at me demandingly. "Do you want to take a walk around town?"
"Not really."
She shook her head, and I understood that I had guessed wrong. But I wasn't going to play her naive little flirting game.
"Then let's please just sit quietly."
Eve went silent. I would gladly have read something, but there was no way to bring stuff in here. This was a medieval fantasy world, where the highest technology available were primitive powder guns made by the gnomes and dwarves. So I'd have to read, or more accurately, reread the in-game encyclopedia. Gnomes provide the dwarves with various kinds of powder weapons, rifles, muskets, and even cannons, and they do not disdain steam power either, among other sorts of technology.
Boring. Why should I care about steam power in the modern age when humanity had already begun colonizing the solar system? Damn, time was drawing on so long. Too bad I couldn't break up the required hour per day into several sessions. That was for health reasons. It was thought to be harmful to the psyche, constantly changing between realities. There were recorded cases where people didn't properly adapt after a vert session. In the game, they rakishly carry heavy two-handed swords, but in the real world, they were weaklings, which at times led people to overestimate their abilities and injure themselves. Feeling bored, I once again opened the interface menu and looked at my profile. Scythe, level 1 human, real name Alex Shepherd, real age 15, class not selected. In sandboxes, you had to show your real name and age. It was thought to cultivate a sense of responsibility in schoolchildren for their behavior in the game. In the first few years, only your nick was shown in your profile and you could generate any appearance. That was a truly blessed time for dorks and losers who took revenge on their real-life bullies in the game. Then a wave of parent outrage swept the globe, and after a brief discussion, real names were added to sandbox profiles and characters were required to look like their IRL counterparts. The next day, almost none of those gankers came to school. Eve stood up. She probably wasn't mad. She always forgave me for stupid jokes. Where are you going?
I'm sick of sitting here, she answered, turning. Want to go take a walk?
I also stood up and we headed to the city gates. On the way, I remembered that 5 minutes earlier I had suggested we take a walk and she had refused. Girls. Mills, the gate guard, tossed us a passing gaze and gave a signal to his partner.
Let them pass.
For the next few seconds, we waited patiently for the gates to open enough to get through. Then we left the city limits. Eve said something about a gift her parents were getting for her birthday, but I was barely listening. The edge of the forest was just 20 yards away when we were caught by a group of running players. I spit out a curse. The last thing we needed were the Dementors. I always thought their leader, Ed, Crawler, looked at me funny. Plus, he teased me whenever he got the chance.
Where are you guys going?
He asked, giving a jocular smile.
A romantic date in the gloomwood? Or are you off to raid some rabbits?
Come on, Rodriguez, I answered. In the last few months, I had grown used to my classmates teasing me. It always followed the same scenario. Now, Malik, Infect, a swarthy thief, would make some joke about my progress, and Bomber, Hung, would pile on. Then Tissa would frown and try to bring her classmates to reason, and Crawler would balk, saying they had no more time to waste on pathetic noobs.
Not likely, Infect said. A rare mob just popped up by the rabbits. They won't be able to take it. Their equipment is too low level.
Do you think they'll attack the butterflies?
Bomber asked, keeping the serious expression on his face. His father was Chinese and his mother Swedish, which at least partially explained how Hung turned out to be a 6'6" wall of muscle.
They're gonna get wiped, 100%.
Ed stopped the act early, though. Waving his rare wand, he left a stream of fiery sparks in the air. Then he took a few steps toward me and said in confidence,
Listen, Scythe. I understand that Aphrodite's family has it made, and her parents will set their daughter up with something cozy. Disgardium doesn't mean squat to her. But what about you?
What about me, Ed?
Call me Crawler, Scythe. This is the game, not the real world.
Back off!
Eve screamed. She stood in front of me and shot Tissa a mean look.
Hey, Aphrodite, we were having a little talk here. For you, all this...
Ed led his hand over everything around.
Means nothing. But for us, it's very important. Much more important than what happens there, where the world is ruled by hypocritical bastards like your parents.
Don't you dare talk about my parents that way,
Eve flared up.
You have no idea what you're talking about.
Oh? Is your father going to be elected prefect? That's what everyone's saying. How many butts did he have to lick? Or is Mr...
Ed made a face and spit.
Oh, Sullivan, not going to share the wealth with his special little princess.
Up yours, dumbass!
Choose your words carefully, fatty,
Tissa said lazily.
And what if I don't? Are you going to kill me? Ha!
Eve was going nuts, and I anxiously placed a hand on her shoulder, but she threw it off.
It's impossible to even really kill someone in your stupid game.
She took a step forward and gave Rodriguez a slap. Ed easily dodged, then unwittingly threw a fireball. His flaming left hand came unclenched, launching a spurt of condensed plasma the size of a walnut. It reached Eve in 1 second, and fire covered her body like napalm. Her clothes, a standard novice's dress, caught fire and burned up in an instant, while her health points fell sharply downward. Eve screamed. Sensations of pain were significantly dulled here, but they did exist. The girl fell to the ground trying to beat out the fire, but the damage was too much for her level one. A few moments later, she died.
Jeez, Crawler, what was that for?
Tissa wrinkled her nose. She could hardly have been talking about the fire. Tissa Schaefer visually mocked Eva's plump body, which was now only in underwear and beginning to flicker. 5 seconds later, it was gone. She left the world.
What, you won't even go to bat for your stupid girlfriend?
Crawler asked acridly, egging me on. If you're talking about her intelligence, she's not stupid, I objected calmly. Definitely not dumber than you.
No, she isn't dumb. You're right there. But still, she's a big piece of crap like the rest of her family.
Crawler provoked me, cradling a new fireball.
Well, come on!
Do you really need a moral justification to kill a much weaker player? At the end of the day...
Mouthing off again, Scythe?
He interrupted.
You'd rather use your tongue than your hands? Ha ha!
Good one. He was thinking of his reputation with the city. Eve attacked him first, so he was defending himself there. It was his right to kill her. Now he was expecting me to do the same.
Coward,
he said, hawking another loogie. This is pointless, Eddie. There are 4 of you, all level 15. I won't even get through your armor. I mean, sure, I could get myself whipped up into a righteous anger and tell you to go to hell. I could even call you a jerk and run at you swinging if that helps you send me to respawn with a clean conscience.
So he is running his mouth, right, guys?
Yep, running his mouth is all he's good for, Crawler,
answered Bomber.
You want me to swat him down without all this heckling? You know, I could...
Let him be.
Tissa interrupted.
We're wasting time.
She turned to leave, but Rodriguez got what he was after. Regardless of what I said, their words hurt me, and I wanted to respond. Hey, Ed, I called. You know what?
What?
He shuddered. At the end of the day, this is just a game. Nothing more. No matter how cool you make yourself here, no matter what you're worth in the game, real life still means something. They were all listening carefully, even Tissa, but they kept silent, and I continued.
And you know what? No matter how hard you try, you're going to have to live in a fake world. And that's if you can pass the citizenship test. Otherwise, the virtual mines, working on plantations, street sweeping, is that life?
Not one muscle twitched on the Dementors' faces. Just a light shadow ran by on Tissa's cheeks. She had lost her mother, and her father worked in Dis. She had no chance at university.
Come on, to the nether with him, guys. We're wasting time,
she said.
Just a sec, guys. The ogres aren't going anywhere.
Crawler walked up to me, coming forehead to forehead.
As long as I've known you, Scythe, you've always thought you were above everyone else. I might not be so smart, but at the very least I have friends. Do you have any friends, Alex Shepard?
Yes, I do.
And who are these invisible friends?
I had no response. Only lonely kids dreamt about space. Everyone else had someone to lose.
Exactly,
Ed nodded.
Think about that, smarty pants. Tissa, buff me.
The priestess of the radiant god renewed everyone's movement speed buffs, and they ran to the west, not looking back. I exited Dis.
Scythe, you have left Disgardium. Please wait to adapt to the real world. Remaining time, 59, 58, 57.
I was immersed in impenetrable darkness. I felt deaf, dumb, and unconscious. Just the flavor of ash was left in my mouth, a trick of the mind as I involuntarily recalled Aphrodite's burned body. Just then the pod went vertical, its sensors relinquished control over my body and handed the reins back to my brain. Then the intragel, which provided balance, shock absorption, and also maintained muscle tone, was sucked into the pod walls for antiseptic treatment and filtration. My senses returned. I was standing in the middle of the pod. Its doors slid aside silently. I crawled out and froze. My hearing was back, and I could immediately tell that my parents were fighting loudly in the other room. Their fights had become a daily occurrence, nothing out of the ordinary. I put on my shorts and t-shirt and went into the kitchen to get a couple sandwiches and a bottle of mineral water, which I was planning to consume as I studied the materials on the Lehman expedition to Mars. But I stopped and listened. My father was trying to get something through to my mom, and he was calm. Now that was weird.
You'll have to tell him, Helene. He's a smart kid. He'll figure it out.
Mark, you're so heartless. This is his last year of school, citizenship tests. Do you even understand what a blow this could be to him? He might not recover.
No, you don't understand.
My father raised his voice.
Sooner or later, he'll have to find out. And let it be sooner rather than later, so he has time to think it all over and decide what to do.
What were they talking about? What was I supposedly going to figure out? I just happened to come out when my mother's mouth was open to answer. Seeing me, she gave a noisy sigh.
Alex.
Mom, Dad, is everything all right?
Everything's all right, buddy. Everything is fine, Father muttered.
His hands rested on my shoulders and we sat on the couch. He tossed a gaze at my upset mom and, looking aside, quietly said,
Alex, your mother and I are getting a divorce.
No, not now. We're going to wait until after your citizenship test.
You're getting a divorce? I repeated stupidly. What about me?
Yes, you.
My dad looked at my mom.
Helene?
No way. This was your idea. You say it. I don't want him to hate me for the rest of his life.
Oh, this was my idea now? He asked, outraged. You should have been thinking about our son when you.
Mark!
My mom whispered.
Not in front of Alex.
My father nodded at her enraged gaze again, but held back. Their flares of tension were so intense I could almost hear them. Hey, so what's all this? Care to explain calmly?
Alex?
Dad coughed out.
We can't afford to pay for your studies. I'm sorry.
But why? I figured I'd misheard. Why?
Divorce will automatically lower our civil status to G. There won't be enough money to pay for university, and we can only help you get set up. You're going to have to start working, son.
Working? With no education? And what, pray tell, did they think I was going to do? Oh, nether. But they were saving for my studies. Or... And what about my college fund? I made up my mind to ask, already knowing the answer.
There he goes,
Mom answered with particular vengeance, looking at my father.
What do you think we've been living on all this time? We haven't had a decent project for a long time.
I looked helplessly at Dad, and he, working his jaws, looked away. But Mom just kept coming at me.
Our income is going to be barely enough to live on. Congratulations, Alex. You'll be an adult soon, and you're going to have to learn to fend for yourself.
But I couldn't hear her or my father, who was saying empty words. Just one idea was clanking around in my head. No outer space? Then I exploded.
This isn't right,
I shouted.
Mom, Dad, what are you talking about? What divorce? Everything is fine, and sure, you fight sometimes, but so does everyone. Every couple fights, but they don't all get divorced.
My face twisted, and trying not to burst into tears like a baby in front of my parents, I turned away.
Sorry, son. Our minds are made up,
came my father's voice from some unfathomable distance.
When you get older, you'll understand.
Sensing my mood, our cat dog AT rubbed up against my leg. He meowed and tapped me with his big forehead. I mechanically picked him up, brought him to my room, and only there let my silent tears out, my head buried in a pillow. No work without higher education. No education without money. My basic income would only be enough for a cupboard in a building for poor L-class citizens, and all I'll have to eat is flavorless universal nutrient blend. So, all I have left is Disgardium?
Chapter 4. Back into the game.
I was in no mood to watch materials on the Mars expedition now, considering that my path there was blocked, perhaps forever. After all, I couldn't get a scholarship. For that, I'd have to be a particularly bright student, at least on my city level. But we had plenty of kids smarter than me. Maybe Ed Rodriguez thought me a smarty pants, but I was never so truly enthralled with learning to go beyond mandatory coursework. I didn't know how long I sat there, staring aimlessly at the ceiling. I didn't pay any attention to my parents' fight flaring up again in the guest room, or to my communicator beeps. The only thing running through my head was, how could two adults be so selfish that they could deprive their only son of his future? What happened? My mind was searching fitfully for other options of how to solve the problem, refusing to accept my new reality and hoping it could all be solved. I even tried to talk to my mom and dad again, but that just got me in trouble and made everything worse. Seemingly, they hated one another so much that they didn't give a damn about me or my future. All they wanted was to forget one another and never see each other again. That's when it dawned on me. Their relationship was like a shattered cup. It could never be glued back together. I'd have to look for other ways of getting money for my education. And the only way to do that was Disgardium. And that actually comforted me. Now I knew what to do, though I didn't yet know what I'd do in the game. But how to get back there? It may have seemed stupid, but I was worried how Ed, Tissa, and the rest would react after all the stuff I'd just said. Why couldn't I have just held my tongue? I was also sorry that I hadn't gone to bat for Eve. After all, today she was my only close friend, and I was leaving her message unread. Feeling pangs of conscience, I picked up my comm and listened to her recorded message.
Hi, how's it going?
Eve's hologram moved into the middle of the room.
Did those bastards finally leave you alone? Don't worry about them, Alex. They're just jealous.
She kept silent, not having made up her mind to continue.
Basically, remember when you said you were going to watch something? If you want, I could come to your place. I mean, it isn't urgent or anything. I just thought...
She finally got too embarrassed, squeezed out a
bye,
and the message came to an end. I valued her tact. She didn't call, she sent a message, so I didn't have to answer. But I did answer, though I kept it brief. I'm going back on Dis. I'll explain next time I see you. After that, I went into the kitchen for food so I could force down some cold sandwiches and mineral water. I was planning to spend a lot of time in the pod, and I didn't have one of the advanced versions that could keep you fed and healthy. I just couldn't forget about my parents' divorce. What went wrong in their lives and when? Ah, to nether with all that. Why keep putting off the inevitable? It was time. Undressed, I walked up to the pod and placed my palm on the sensor. It read my prints, lit up green, and gave a welcoming beep. The pod doors opened. Going inside, I grabbed the handles and launched startup. The pod closed, the lighting went out, and Intragel quickly filled the tube. I winced reflexively. Loading. I took a breath, filling my lungs with piney air and feeling rays of the sun baking my skin. I was surrounded by a bright and astonishing forest. A huge butterfly flew by, brushing my cheek with a wing. Trying to catch it, I took an awkward step and heard a branch crunch underfoot. My bare foot shot with pain, and I swore for a while, then spent a bit of time sitting on a stone on the roadside, fishing out the splinter. I finished and looked around in search of hostile mobs, then decided to think up a plan of action. I had to begin with a look at my character. This time I wasn't just browsing my stats in boredom, though. I was looking carefully, absorbed. Scythe, level 1 human. Real name, Alex Shepherd. Real age, 15. Class, not selected. Main attributes, strength, 2. Perception, 2. Endurance, 3. Charisma, 2. Intelligence, 2. Agility, 2. Luck, 2. Secondary attributes, health points, 23 out of 23. Mana points, 12 out of 12. Recovery speed, 9 health points per minute. Movement speed bonus 2%, base damage 1.2, carrying capacity 108 pounds, accuracy 20%, spell power bonus 2.4%, dodge chance plus 4%, critical damage chance plus 5%, vendor discount plus 2%, chance of receiving a unique quest plus 0.2%, Chance of receiving improved loot, plus 0.2%. Fame, zero. As for clothing, I was wearing only standard novice stuff, no bonuses. Canvas pants and shirt, not even any footwear. In the game's quality scale, my stuff was gray. The items were such low quality, no vendor would even buy them. Normal white stuff was a bit better, somewhat more durable, but no bonuses. Bonuses started with the unusual green. At the first levels, getting an enchanted green object was akin to a miracle. There were also supposedly rare blue, epic purple, and orange legendary, as well as some set and scalable items. But I hadn't crawled far enough into the thicket of the game encyclopedia to even know what the last two were. And it was probably not going to be relevant for the foreseeable future. This was my gear. Novice's canvas pants. Shoddy. Cloth armor. Armor, 1. Durability, 4 out of 10. Requires level 1. Sell price, 0. Novice's canvas shirt. Shoddy. Cloth armor. Armor, 1. Durability, 7 out of 10. Requires level 1. Sell price, 0. The pants had less durability than the shirt after a memorable battle with an aggressive level 2 bunny. I could probably have repaired it, i.e. gotten a patch and sewn it on, but that required a separate skill. Or to pay a tailor. That was the most painful issue in Disgardium, especially when you realized that after the sandbox, game money could be easily withdrawn as real phoenixes. And, by the way, I personally didn't have a single bronze coin to my name. Basically, this novice gear was given to everyone. If I died, I could find a new set in my personal chest in the tavern. Identical canvas pants and shirt down to the stitching. Farming mobs, unarmed, with my stats was not only a drawn-out process, it smelled of masochism. So I would have to earn XP with long and routine social quests. Fetching, delivering, cleaning, collecting. Experience and money. Money and experience. I needed to get together at least 10 silver for more serious gear, and maybe not a sword, but at least some shabby dagger. Out of the way! Someone hit me with their shoulder as they ran past. Unable to keep my balance, I fell off the road face first into mud. A few more people ran past after him. Where are you going? I threw out, not expecting an answer. A Class Z threat! A strangely dressed level 6 archer turned and shouted back at me. He had a helmet on his head that looked to be a cast iron pot and was forced to hold it with one hand to keep it from falling off as he ran. Some necromancer raised a churchyard. Ah, that was it. The game gave generous rewards for eliminating threats to the world. If you let a necromancer go wild, he might take over the globe. I got up, shook off the clods of damp soil, and, walking cautiously to the edge of the path, headed to town. Players were rushing not to miss the threat, and that was only to my advantage. Maybe we'd be able to take some kind of quest before evening while the city council was at work. A large amount of Tristad's quests were given by the chief councilman, although that was only during the day while he was at work. Other NPCs lived their own lives and gave out quests only if they actually needed something. Approaching the city walls, I saw a row of black market merchants stretched out along them. These were players just like me who didn't want to pay commission to the auctioneer or waste money on a market license. Or maybe they just wanted to unload their goods on the cheap. Now, honestly, there weren't very many people. I guess most of them had run off to eliminate the threat. The sun was already starting to sink behind the city wall, and shadows were falling on the market stalls. The monotone hum of commerce split into distinct cries of admonishment and the sound of people doing business.
Woven battle jacket, plus 2 strength, just 3 gold. Minor healing potions, bulk discounts.
Endurance and agility scrolls, from leveling prof, selling at cost.
Just what do you think you're doing? Those ingredients aren't worth a penny. And what are you selling those things at, you miser?
I don't have any anti-greed scrolls. Keep walking.
I decided to walk past and get some prices. I would have to get somewhat more appropriate gear and figure this all out eventually. For the most part, they were selling trash, second-hand goods, things grown out of, nothing of particular value, often missing some durability. Still, it was cheaper than buying new.
Are you looking for something in particular?
Someone's hoarse voice made me turn around. A short, lean level 9 player with the apt nick of underweight looked over what I had on, then shrugged and came to a conclusion.
Not likely.
You a beginner?
Asked a very tall girl by the name of Overweight sitting next to him. In fact, she was half a head taller than me. In front of her, there were piles of weapons sorted by type. Underweight had primarily clothing and armor. Sure, I guess they'd found their niche. Take stuff on consignment or buy for more than the NPC merchants, then resell at a premium.
I don't think so,
Underweight answered.
He's 15, that means he's already spent a year here at least.
Wait a minute, I think this is that weirdo who's always sitting next to the tavern. That's right.
She turned to me.
Is it you?
Yes, it is. Scythe.
How can we help you, Scythe?
The traders asked in unison. I'm getting an idea of what I can buy to easily farm mobs.
Got it,
the boy exclaimed.
We'll show you everything. So, level 1, what's your strength?
2.
How much? 2? That, putting it lightly, was pretty dumb, bro.
I see. That means plate and mail are out. Give me a minute. Underweight snorted, digging through the cloth and leather armor, setting things that might work for me in a separate pile. I shifted from foot to foot, thinking and listening to what the other sellers were shouting. I could make it to the city council building. There was still time. But then...
Don't listen to him,
Overweight said.
Maybe you want to be a mage or a bard? Is there some reason you just hang around the tavern all the time?
I haven't really thought about it.
Well, there is still time. You can still make it. But you better figure out now so you level the right stats from here on.
Thanks.
Think nothing of it. It's common knowledge.
Still, thank you, Overweight. And hey, why do you have that nick?
You can't tell by looking? What do you think?
She snorted.
He's a hat rack, and me, I've got big bones.
She couldn't be called fat, but she definitely wasn't delicate either, more like curvy. Plumpest of all were her thighs. Laughing it off, she took a skeptical look at her partner, his head buried in a pile of gear, then asked,
Well, handsome, got any money?
Not even 1 copper, I admitted. I haven't done any work here.
So then what made you waste all that time?
I wasn't having fun, I shrugged, not knowing what else to say about my lack of activity in Dis.
It happens, but it's a shame. And you know why?
I can guess.
Because we don't sell on credit,
the merchant shouted.
Listen, Undy, false alarm. This schmo doesn't have any money. Empty pockets.
What?
He whooped, throwing some shoulder pads in a fit and raising his head.
What are you doing wasting my time then, lazy bones?
Underweight finished up and was not planning to continue. He stood at the improvised counter and looked angrily, puffing his nostrils. He was a head shorter than her, even though he was human, not a gnome, which was funny to look at. I'm not here to waste your time, Mr. Underweight. I said up front I was just looking, not planning to buy. So you think you can tell me what you've got? He looked untrustingly, did the math, and a smile spread out on his face.
My apologies for the flare-up. That was just a misunderstanding. Our small but proud enterprise is always happy to give some help to beginners.
And what does your small but proud enterprise have to offer a noob like me?
Well, take a look.
Underweight turned serious.
I picked out some cloth armor for you and a few leather pieces. The main one is a normal cloth condor set, a chest wrap, pants, braces, and shoulder pads. All white with no bonuses, but altogether it gives a good boost to strength. I recommend you take leather boots right away and high ones at that. The main mobs are shorter than you at the beginning, so the first thing they'll bite at is your feet. I've got a leather belt, too, though it is a bit shabby. But it does have a 1-point endurance bonus. That'll help you survive a bite or 2 extra. Also, it's best to take leather gloves, but I don't have any right now, sorry.
Come on, Undy,
Overweight shot out.
But will he ever get money?
He smiled.
We don't sell on credit.
There's a first time for everything, Rita.
Not turning his gaze from me, the trader kept smirking. I'm going to do you a favor, brother. I'll give you this whole excellent set of beginner armor, which is worth more than 2 gold, if you do 2 little things for me.
I pay you back 20 for the 2? I smiled skeptically.
You pay me back exactly what I give you, 2 gold and 20 silver, and that's with a wholesale discount.
Underweight raised his index finger.
But when you grow out of the set, you give it back to me.
So you'd lease it to me?
Yes. What kind of time frame were you thinking for payment? How about a week?
No, thanks.
No? Are you serious?
In that gear, you'll be mopping up the city jail all by yourself tomorrow.
Haha, very funny. Not likely, but thanks for the offer. As soon as I manage to earn some money, I'll come back and buy something. Sorry for wasting your time. The girl elbowed her partner in the ribs. He cast a dismayed gaze and sighed.
Okay, bro, but this is a special offer and only because you're such a weirdo.
Underweight, thank you, but I have to go. I still needed to reach the chief councilman, and I had no interest in continuing to discuss moneylending. I didn't know why, but I wanted to live within my means.
Hear me out. 50 silver a week, hmm?
All right, I'll consider it. Thanks.
All right.
He nodded and patted me on the shoulder.
If you reconsider, you know where to find us. Good luck, brother.
I had already taken it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.